RT is catching up with John Perkins, economist, activist, and author. One of his best-selling books, Confessions of an Economic Hitman, has been translated into over 30 languages. It is an insider's account of the alleged exploitation of third-world countries by the American government. Sir, thank you very much for sitting down with us. You have been an economic hitman for about 10 years. What exactly does that job entail?
We economic hitmen have created the world's first truly global empire. And it's the first empire in history that's been created primarily without the military, through economics. And we work many different ways, economic hitmen, but perhaps the most common is that we will identify a third world country that has resources our corporations covet, like oil, and then arrange a huge loan to that country from the World Bank or one of its sister organizations. But the money never actually goes to the country. Instead, it goes to our own corporations to build big infrastructure projects in that country, things like power plants and industrial parks and highways that benefit a few wealthy families in that country, as well as our own corporations, but don't help the majority of the people. The whole country is left holding this huge debt, and it's such a big debt that they can't repay it. So at some point, we economic hitmen go back to them and say, you can't pay your debts, so give us a pound of flesh, sell your oil real cheap to our oil companies, or vote with us on the next critical United Nations vote, or send troops in support of ours to someplace in the world like Iraq. When we fail, then what we call the jackals step in, and these are people who overthrow governments or assassinate their leaders. And on the very few occasions when both the economic hitmen and the jackals fail, as we both did in Iraq, then and only then does the military step in. And it's pretty secret, because most people in the United States don't realize that they're reaping the benefits from this empire. They don't realize about the exploitation of resources and environments and people and sweatshops and so on all over the world that are the result of this. I think it's fair to say that this process is a huge threat to democracy, and if the majority of the people who vote in a country don't understand this most basic principle of our foreign policy, then we're not informed. And if we're not informed, it's hard to say that we're voting truly democratically, which I think is a big concern.
And this isn't considered illegal under international law because it's kept secret, or how does it work?
Well, the process isn't illegal at all. The process of identifying countries that have resources you covet and then giving them huge loans. And through macroeconomics, you can in fact show that when we make these loans to these countries, the economy increases. But what wasn't shown, what isn't shown, is that in many of these countries, only a few people really benefit. And they are really the major contributors to the economy, the very wealthy families. And the majority of the people end up being worse off.
You said United States hitmen failed in Iraq. What happened exactly?
In order to really understand Iraq, we have to look at Saudi Arabia first. Because in the early 70s, Saudi Arabia stopped selling oil, OPEC stopped selling oil to the United States. And the U.S. Treasury Department came to me and some other economic hitmen and said, you can't let OPEC hold us up for ransom anymore. Do something. So we knew we had to work out a deal with the House of Saud, the royal family of Saudi Arabia. And eventually we worked out this deal whereby the Saudis agreed to return most of the money they made selling oil to the world to the United States and buy U.S. government securities. The interest from those government securities was basically turned over to our Treasury Department and used to hire American companies to westernize Saudi Arabia, to build desalinization plants, petrochemical complexes, cities. And also Saudi agreed not to sell oil for anything other than dollars, which made the dollar very strong at that point. And we agreed to keep the House of Saud in power. It was an amazing deal that we put together. And after that, it was so successful, we decided we ought to sell the same deal to Saddam Hussein in Iraq. Iraq was the next largest producer of oil. We wanted to get Saddam in bed with us, basically. But he wouldn't buy. He wouldn't accept it. If he had, he'd still be running his country, I'm convinced. He wouldn't buy, so we sent the jackals in to assassinate him. They couldn't. He had very good security. He had look-alike doubles. So his own security officers never knew whether they were actually guarding him or somebody else. That makes it very difficult to take someone out. He was very savvy. He knew our system pretty well. We'd at one time hired him, in fact, to be an assassin of another, of a former president, a premier of Iraq. So we sent the military in 1991, destroyed his army, And at that time, of course, we could have taken Saddam Hussein out, but we decided not to. He was the kind of strong man we like, someone who could keep the Iranians in their borders, keep control of the Kurds, and keep pumping oil to us. And we figured that by destroying his military, we'd chastised him sufficiently that now he'd come around. So in the 90s, the economic hitmen went back in and tried to bring him around. Couldn't do it again. He was obstinate. And again, the jackals couldn't take him out, so we formulated the second invasion and sent the troops in again, and this time, of course, we took him out.
Your book, Confessions of an Economic Hitman, caused a lot of controversy. What was the reaction of the U.S. government?
The American government, I think, and a lot of the American press wanted to ignore Confessions of an Economic Hitman. The book was on the New York Times bestseller list for about a year and a half, and the New York Times never reviewed it. The State Department issued a website called Misinformation or something, and my book was the only book listed on that website that for a long period of time where people were told, this book is wrong. And to me, it was farcical.
You have claimed that the United States government has been wanting to create a global empire. Do you think that is still the case?
The United States, certainly under the Bush administration, was very much involved in empire expansion. And what we were doing in Iraq was totally into that. However, it got itself into a lot of trouble. So by being in Iraq and Afghanistan in such a big way, so committed, it meant that when Hugo Chavez of Venezuela, for example, got on the bad side of the administration and the CIA was sent in to overthrow him, a coup was staged in 2002 against Chavez, and Chavez was able to overcome the coup. At that point, under older regimes, we would have gone in and done something much more massive against Chavez. But because we were so extended, overextended, in Afghanistan, in Iraq, the Bush administration really had its hands tied. It couldn't go into Venezuela. In the process of trying to expand this empire, and I think in the process of moving away from the economic hitman approach into the more, going back to the more militarized approach, as the Bush administration did in Iraq and Afghanistan, has created a huge problem for the United States. So it can no longer continue in this mode.
Where do you think the United States is heading in terms of its ties with other nations?
Nations aren't very important anymore as power brokers, big corporations. They really are calling the shots. In whatever country you're in today, corporations have tremendous power. We have a new president now, Obama, and one of the things that he ran under was that he didn't accept money from big institutions, but in fact he did. He accepted a lot of hedge fund money, a lot of money that came through corporations in one way or another. And even if we had a president that wouldn't be influenced by corporations, he's got to deal with a Congress that's terribly influenced by corporations, Senate and House of Representatives both, and all the local governments. Corporations are the powers today. And so when we talk about modern geopolitics, we've really got to look at the corporations.
So in your opinion, is it the corporations that are responsible for the economic crisis that the United States is struggling through right now?
I think it's fair to say that the corporations are responsible for the economic crisis that the United States and the rest of the world is getting deeply involved in. The government of the United States has to take a lot of responsibility. In fact, if you look at the top of the corporate world and the government world, you've usually got the same people. In the United States, at least, they move back and forth through what we call the revolving door policies.
Do you think a solution could be found to this global economic crisis? Because many analysts are predicting that basically a light at the end of the tunnel is nowhere in sight. What are your predictions?
I believe there is a light at the end of the tunnel to this economic crisis. I think it's, frankly, a good thing that we're going through it. But, you know, we've been living in a very unbalanced world. Less than 5% of the world's population lives in the United States, and we consume more than 25% of the world's resources. At the same time, roughly half the world's population lives beneath the poverty level. That's not a world that can be called a success. We have to change.
One of your books is called Secret History of the American Empire. Nowadays, does the United States still exist as an empire? Should it be considered as an empire?
An American empire, if we look at it that way, is an American-based empire, which now has become really a global empire that's really run by the corporatocracy, which is the heads of big corporations. And it just so happens that the majority of them have their headquarters in the United States.
What about people who are less optimistic and who say that basically the United States might be headed towards the exit, just may basically collapse because of so many problems that it's faced with right now?
You know, it's entirely possible that the economy will collapse, that the United States will collapse, that the world economy will collapse, and out of that will grow something else. It'll have to, out of the ruins, something new will take seed. I want to believe that we can not collapse, but change, and the whole world can change, and the whole world economy. And I think we have a really good shot at doing that, and we do something about it. The other possibility is we don't read the signs. We just go into decline, and then we'll have terrible turmoil and chaos, and there'll be a tremendous amount of suffering. The signs are out there.
Sir, thank you very much for your time today.
It's my pleasure.